In each life cycle, we follow the human journey, and we will aim to address these questions. Helping us begin to answer these questions is our first speaker, Chairman of the Breakthrough Prize Foundation. Please welcome to the stage, Pete Warden. All right, Pete, the stage is yours.
Thank you. How's everyone doing today? Good? It's early in the morning. This is my second Pioneers Festival. What I'd like to do today is talk about the question of life in the universe, and I'm going to really mean the universe beyond Earth. I represent a scientific foundation that was founded about 9 years ago. We are sponsored by some of the most successful entrepreneurs in the world, including Mark Zuckerberg from Facebook, Sergey Brin from Google, Ann Wojcicki from 23andMe, Yuri Milner, DST Global, Pony Ma from Tencent. And we have a couple efforts that we do, but the one I mostly want to talk about are the breakthrough initiatives. And these were announced in 2015 at the Royal Society in London as a series of research projects that are privately funded to answer some fundamental questions. And there's really, to my mind, three of these. Are we alone is the fundamental one. Is there life elsewhere? Anywhere, and as of right now, we don't know of any life beyond Earth. And maybe even more significant, is there intelligent life anywhere? Now, whenever I ask this question, people say, well, is there intelligent life here? And I have to tell you, the closer you get to certain national capitals like Washington or London, it's a questionable issue. And maybe the most significant to me personally is, can we travel to other stars? And just to tell you, this is hard. The next nearest star system, which I'm going to talk about briefly, is 300,000 times further away than our sun. Well, one of the other things I probably should say that the Breakthrough Prize Foundation gives the world's largest prizes in science. These are six $3 million prizes in life sciences, physics, and mathematics. They're over two times bigger than some Swedish prize I'm not supposed to mention. But I really want to point out that that this last year we were very honored to give a special physics prize to Jocelyn Bell Burnell. You see her picture here. She was the real discoverer of the pulsar, which was somehow overlooked by that Swedish committee. And so she won this prize. But in addition, she gave the $3 million to underserved groups for fellowships. So I really think she's a neat person. Well, let me talk about the third question, the question of can we travel between the stars. And this is Project Starshot. It was begun in 2016. Until he passed away last year, Stephen Hawking was our principal science advisor. And its objectives are pretty simple, but very hard. First, we want to determine, is there any life-bearing planets orbiting one of these nearest stars, particularly the Alpha Centauri system, which I'll talk about. This is the nearest star system beyond the sun. We would like to see if we could send a probe sometime by the middle of the century to take science data and transmit it back to Earth. So if we can determine other planets, is there evidence of life? We'd like to launch within about two, 3 decades. And when we say affordable cost, we'd like to do this for typical large space project or science project cost, roughly 10 million euros. Now to do this, because we'd like to get there in reasonable time, we have to go fast, which is a very technical term. It basically means 20% the speed of light. And we looked at how to do this, and this is not easy. The first thing we felt is we could make a spacecraft really, really small, and if we could leave the rocket engine on Earth and use a different way to propel something. In our case, we'd like to use a sail, a very old technology, but it's a light sail, not a wind sail. Then we would use a very powerful laser. And when I mean powerful, I mean powerful. This is a kilometer square laser that has 100 gigawatts of power. And we think this might be possible within the next couple decades, is a totally new way to propel things in space. We're seeing a lot of advances in photonics, the use of lasers for communication, and in microelectronics. So this has enabled us to make a really small spacecraft, and I brought one with me in my pocket. This is what we call a star chip. It's, you can see the plastic, but there's a little tiny electronic chip about the size of a chip in your Apple Watch. This is a technology that's maturing. This is a complete spacecraft. Bigger versions of this have been launched. So we hope to work the research for this in the next couple decades. Now we have a second project which says, well, is there any place to go with this spacecraft? This is the Alpha Centauri system. It's 4.3 light years away. There are three stars in this system. Two of them are kind of like the sun, and the third one is a little small, it's, you know, 10% the solar mass, but it's still about 100 times bigger than the Earth in terms of size. And we want to find out, are there planets in this system? Are there planets that might have life? To do this, and as I speak, we have a instrument on the European Southern Observatory's very large telescope. By the way, they're building a new telescope called the Extremely Large Telescope. Not very imaginative title. I understand it used to be called the Overwhelmingly Large Telescope, but they had a budget cut. But with this, we hope to be able to see planets to send this to. Now, I want to close with a couple minutes on a really speculative issue. And this is the question of, can life actually migrate from one planet to another? And this is an area called panspermia, although we had a conference on this a few weeks ago and a lot of people thought we should call it panovaria. So there's an argument about this title. Our question was, can life go between planets? And could it even be that there are intelligent messages in life? And can we actually think about having life transmitted by us, Earth life, elsewhere? I won't go into a lot of details, but there's a whole set of questions about how life originated on Earth. Some people think it happened in the bottom of the ocean. Other people think that it goes between planets by asteroid impact. But one of the most interesting questions is, can life go between star systems? And until recently, most astronomers would have said, no, that's just rubbish. But last year, we found our first interstellar visitor. This is the first asteroid from another star system. It was called Oumuamua, which is ancient Hawaiian for traveler, distant traveler. But this was a very interesting object because some scientists, I'll say a minority, actually think that what it really was something like this, a star chip attached to a light sail. So it's a very speculative issue. But the question is could intelligent species, including us, figure out how to go between stars and actually plant life elsewhere? This was called directed panspermia. It was proposed by the late Nobel Prize winner, Francis Crick, who co-won the Nobel Prize for the discovery of DNA, and one of his colleagues. But this is the intentional seeding of life between star systems to other planets by us. Now, I put this guy's picture up. This is George Church. He also looks like God a little bit, I think. At least how I imagined God when I was a kid. He's a very famous geneticist at Harvard University. Among other things, he's trying to resurrect woolly mammoths. But he proposed that what we could do is take life, or even biomechanical life, something that we invented, put it in one of these chips, and send it to a planet orbiting one of the nearby stars, and boot up life. Now, to be sure, there's a lot of ethics issues. There's a lot of political issues. And so this is going to be a major area of discussion over the future. But I think we may be living in one of the most exciting periods of history, that for the first time, not only may we answer, is there life elsewhere, but we may have the ability through these new technologies to send our life elsewhere. And I'd just like to close. This is an artist conception of there is a planet about the size of the Earth orbiting the small star in the Alpha Centauri system, Proxima. This is an artist's conception of that planet. It probably is much cooler looking than the planet really is. But this may be where we plant life in the future. Thank you much. Look forward to a lot of cool discussions with you.